Hello everyone and welcome to the class. Today we'll be talking about urinary tract infections. Basically, since it's a course in pharmacology, we'll be talking about the drugs that are used in case of urinary tract infections. So let us have a look. The things that we'll be dealing with today is basically we'll be talking about the basic idea of urinary tract infections, learn about the various causes of urinary tract infections, the etiology of urinary tract infections, and we'll also talk about the clinical features and symptoms of urinary tract infections. We'll be talking about all these things in brief before we move on to talk about the various treatment options in practice. Okay, so let us look at the contents. As I just said, in case of learning objectives, the contents will deal with basic idea about urinary tract infections, the causes of UTIs, the etiology of UTIs, the clinical features and the symptoms of UTIs, and the treatment options in practice, like potassium citrate, trimethoprim, nitrofurantoin, amoxicillin, phosphomycin, quinolones and chloroquinolones, and methamphetamine. Okay, now coming on to UTIs. So what is urinary tract infection? Urinary tract infection refers to the infections in the urinary tract. And this occurs when a microbial agent, usually bacterial, it invades and colonizes the urinary tract. UTIs is mostly an ascending kind of bacterial infection. Though it can also come from, it can be of hematologic origin or from lymphoid origin as well. So let us look into the causes of urinary tract infections. One, the most important cause is the anatomical factor. And because of the anatomical factor, the women are more prone to urinary tract infections as compared to men. Okay, now let's look at the second cause of UTIs. The second cause of UTI encompasses benign prostatic hyperplasia. So what is benign prostatic hyperplasia? As the word hyperplasia means, there is increase in the number of cells, right, in the prostate region, but it is benign. It's not malignant, so it's not going to cause a big trouble right away. However, because there is hyperplasia, the prostate region enlarges, and because of the enlargement of the prostate, it is very difficult for the person to pass urine. That's why there is stasis of urine in the urinary bladder, and this stasis of urine in the urinary bladder favors the growth of the bacteria, thereby resulting in urinary tract infections. So similarly, again, kidney stone, it also obstructs the flow of urination, and thereby this also leads to urinary tract infection. Similarly, diabetes and other different chronic diseases which impair the immune system also lead to urinary tract infections. Likely, chronic corticosteroid therapy or cancer chemotherapy, they are also known to impair immunity and thereby lead to urinary tract infections. Another reason is history of recent catheterization. Catheterization has been known to cause maximum cases of hospital-acquired infections or healthcare-associated infections. And among all the healthcare-associated infections, UTIs occupy the largest position. And for the UTIs, catheterization is known to have a much larger share of the infections. Okay, just earlier we said that because of the anatomy, it is more common for a woman to suffer from UTIs as compared to men, right? So let's have a look at the differences that are seen in case of women and men. The urethra is generally short in women, right? The length of the urethra in women is 3 to 4 centimeters. That's why it is very short, and again its placement is near the vagina. So this makes it easy for the bacteria to enter the urinary tract. The vagina itself, it allows the entry of bacterium from the rectum or from outside the body, and this bacteria can then be transferred into the urethra. While in case of men, the penis comes in contact with bacteria, but however, due to the large urethra, there is little bit trouble for the bacteria to get into the urinary tract to cause infections. The length of the urethra in men is around 20 centimeters, while in case of women, as we just said, is around 3 to 4 centimeters. And this longer urethra in men makes it difficult for the bacteria to reach the inner structures. The prostate, which we just earlier talked in case of benign prostatic hyperplasia, is a causes problem when there is prostatic hyperplasia. So as men age, there is an enlargement of the prostate, and this causes the blockage of urine flow, thereby leading to infections. The rectum, we normally know that it has lots of bacteria in it, and the bacteria can go, the bacteria that are present in the rectum can travel to the urethra in case of female, and then lead to urinary tract infections more commonly. That is the very reason why female are said to have almost 4 times more urinary tract infections as compared to men, and this number is known to vary. Nevertheless, it is always the female who suffer more from UTIs as compared to men. And when a non-pregnant normal female suffers from urinary tract infections, we call it an uncomplicated infection. While urinary tract infection that occurs in male or in case of pregnant women or in case of child and elderly are all labeled as complicated urinary tract infections. So when the urinary tract infection starts, as I said earlier, that most of the urinary tract infections are of ascending type, right? That's why it generally starts at the level of urethra, causing urethritis, and then it can travel up to the bladder. If the urinary tract infection is at the level of the bladder, we call it cystitis. And once there is cystitis, then again it may travel up the ureters to the kidneys, thereby resulting in pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis is the inflammation, is the infection of the kidneys, and from kidneys, it can again go to the bloodstream as well, right? Because via the renal vein. Again, if this is not a case of ascending bacterial infection or ascending infections, then again, via septicemia, again, urinary tract infections can occur. If the person is septicemic, then urinary tract infections can occur as a result of the infections coming from the blood to the kidneys as well. But that case is relatively very, very less as compared to the normal ascending bacterial infections. Okay, let us look into the etiology of UTIs. The ascending bacterial infections account for most UTIs, as we just discussed earlier. Right? The another case of UTIs is the retention and residual urine that results from over-distension or incomplete emptying of the bladder. And it may be a catheter-associated urinary tract infections, which we normally call CA UTIs. So the temporary urine retention will also be due to decreased perception of the urge to void that may result from perineal trauma following childbirth, and also due to the effects of the analgesia and anesthesia as well. The urinary stasis and residual urine, it provides a medium for bacterial growth, thereby predisposing the person to cystitis or pyelonephritis. Now, let us have a look at the various causative organisms for UTIs. The most common causative organism for UTI is E. coli. And following E. coli, there are other organisms like Proteus, Pseudomonas, Staph aureus, Streptococcus faecalis, right? And there is also a picture image given at the right-hand side. You can have a look. There are the organisms are divided into two categories, gram-negative organisms and gram-positive organisms. Again here, E. coli ranks the highest, as we said earlier, and then comes Proteus, Klebsiella, Citrobacter, Enterobacter, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and others, right? Also, in case of gram-positive organisms, there is Staph, Saprophyticus, Enterococci, Group B Streptococci, and Streptophilococcus aureus. The consequences of not recognizing early symptoms of UTI can include the extension of infection with subsequent and even permanent loss of kidney function. And another problem is that the pregnant woman normally, when they have contract UTIs, then they may be asymptomatic. So it is very important for diagnosing UTI in case of pregnant woman, because that can have different problems with regards it can pose different problems both for the mother and the child, the unborn child, the fetus, right? It can go from growth retardation to pyelonephritis, and it can cause intrauterine death as well in some cases. We talked earlier about ascending bacterial infections in UTIs, right? So let us have a look. The contamination of the periurethral area with uropathogenic E. coli is given as an example over here. E. coli, they have got fimbriae out here. That's why it makes easier for them to enter the bacteria first to get into the urethra, right? And then travel upstream. The appendages that is present in the cells of the E. coli, it helps in attachment. And uropathogens, they normally have either flagella or cilia that helps in attachment with to the inner structures. And that is how they travel all the way up to the kidneys or to the bloodstream itself. So at the first, the pathogens, they cause infection in the urethral region, which we call urethritis. Then it travels up, causing cystitis, and then by ureter, they go all the way to the kidneys, thereby causing acute pyelonephritis. So that was the case of ascending route, right? And likewise, there is also hematogenous route in which the urinary tract infection can follow sepsis, and there can be again another lymphatic route as well. However, the most of the cases are caused by ascending bacterial infections or the ascending route. Okay, let us have a look at the clinical features. Frequent burning micturition is one of the most common clinical feature of UTIs. Then there is dysuria and hematuria. Hematuria is relatively rare condition. However, hematuria can sometimes be gross hematuria or microscopic hematuria. In most of the times, even when there is hematuria, it is mostly the microscopic hematuria where the blood cells can be seen only under the microscope. However, in some cases, gross hematuria or frank hematuria can be seen, in which case the whole urine turns red in color. There is cloudy and strong smelling urine. Again, cloudy and strong smelling urine is because of urinary stasis or accumulation of urine in the bladder for a long period of time, which has favored urinary tract infection in the first place. Then there can be blowing pain, fever with chills, and rigor in the upper urinary tract infection, and pain during sexual intercourse, which is also known as dyspareunia. Okay, let us have a look at UTIs and symptoms based on the position of the infection. So the first case we discussed earlier was urethritis, where there is infection in the urethra. There is burning sensation during the urination and penile discharge in case of male. The second case is cystitis or urinary bladder infection. The lower abdominal discomfort is seen there. Frequent and painful urination, pungent smelling urine is present in case of cystitis. And in case of acute pyelonephritis or the inflammation of the kidneys, there is upper back and flank pain, high fever and second chills and gut distress. Okay, have a look at this picture. This picture here shows cystitis and pyelonephritis, right? It has basically given all the symptoms that happen in case of cystitis or the bladder infection, and it has also shown the empiric treatment therapy and also the alternatives that are used in case of cystitis. Similarly, it has also given the various features in case of pyelonephritis and also the empiric regimen that is used. Okay, so what is empiric therapy? Do you remember from the time we talked about antibiotics? Empiric therapy is the one when you have sent for culture and sensitivity of the, you have sent a sample for culture and sensitivity. However, you still have not got the results from the lab. And meanwhile, when you are waiting for culture and sensitivity results, you still need to move ahead with the treatment. In that case, what you need to do is you need to follow the empiric therapy. The therapy that you give is basically you give a broad spectrum antibiotic with the knowledge that you have of the infective organisms. If the person has shown the cases of UTI in the recent days, let's say within a span of 2 months, if the person has the case of UTI within a span of 2 months, then in that case, we take it as the last antibiotic therapy not being adequate for the treatment of the organism, and we likely assume that it is the same organism that has caused infection this time as well. So we use another agent that is useful in case of that very organism. However, if it is more than 2 months that the previous infection occurred, then we look into the various infective agents that are prevalent in that very locality, and we also look at the patient history, and we give the broad spectrum antibiotic that fits the organism or that is able to kill the organism or inhibit the growth of the organism. This is empiric therapy. And once the data from culture and sensitivity has come back, we shift to the narrow spectrum antibiotic, and we choose the one which has got narrow spectrum from among the options, you know, which has shown sensitivity to the drug, and we move ahead with the treatment that is called definitive treatment. In case of cystitis, the empiric treatment starts with nitrofurantoin mostly, and the alternatives may be trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole or fosfomycin. In case of pyelonephritis, the empiric treatment starts with IV ceftriaxone, and the alternatives can be piperacillin, tazobactam as well. In case of extended spectrum beta-lactamase secreting organisms, ESBL positive organisms, what they basically do is they inactivate the penicillin, cephalosporins, and even aspirin, right? So this will be treated with carbapenems like meropenem, etrapenem, imipenem like drugs. Okay, earlier when we were talking about UTIs, we had mentioned in one place about catheter-associated UTIs, right? And we also said that healthcare-associated infections, in case of healthcare-associated infections, lot of infections are result in UTI. So this very article, it states that 36% of the healthcare-associated infections are UTI. And out of all this UTIs, 80% of UTIs are generally catheter related. Let us have a look at the different kinds of catheters that are used in healthcare settings. The first catheter out here is simple urethral catheter, A, right? The another one is open-ended or whistle tip catheter. B, C is cowl catheter or Tymann catheter. D is milk cord catheter or wing tip catheter. E is mushroom catheter. And F is Foley's catheter. Foley's catheter is most commonly used kind of catheter. Okay. Regarding urinary tract infections, we had earlier said that they can be classified into complicated as well as non-complicated UTIs, right? So an infection is considered to be complicated if it affects the pregnant woman, children, men, or elderly, or if it affects the upper urinary tract that is causing pyelonephritis. An uncomplicated UTI is the one which involves lower urinary tract, encompasses the syndrome of acute dysuria and the frequency in otherwise healthy non-pregnant women. Okay, this is a slide for UTIs in pregnancy. Pregnancy causes numerous changes in the woman's body, and this predisposes the woman to different kinds of urinary tract infections. The hormonal and the mechanical changes that happen during pregnancy promotes the urinary stasis and thereby leads to urinary tract infections. If urinary tract infection is the most common bacterial infection that occurs during pregnancy, and a person in pregnancy is always should be checked for UTI multiple times during the pregnant state. It is associated with risk to both the fetus and the mother, including pyelonephritis, preterm birth, low birth weight, and increased perinatal mortality. Oral antibiotics are the treatment of choice for cystitis and asymptomatic bacteriuria. Okay, do you remember what is bacteriuria? Well, bacteriuria is the presence of bacteria in the urine. There are a lot of different studies which say that the treatment of bacteriuria, if it is asymptomatic, may not be necessary in case of other uncomplicated cases, right? Uncomplicated UTIs or bacteriuria when asymptomatic may not need to be treated if the person is not pregnant. But however, in case of pregnant woman, asymptomatic bacteriuria should be treated. Okay, now let us move into the symptoms. For a person with mild symptoms, potassium citrate mixture in a glass of water given on an 8-hourly basis helps recover. If the person is moderate to severe, then there might be need to take different antibiotics. In case of urinary tract infections, we use either different kinds of antibiotics or a different class of drug which we call urinary antiseptics. Amoxicillin, norfloxacillin, trimethoprim, fosfomycin, these all are antibiotics that are used in case of urinary tract infections. Nitrofurantoin is an example of urinary antiseptic. Okay. In case of recurrent case, that is if it happens more than 3 times per annum, then it is mandatory that we look into the cause and treat the cause accordingly. And the patient should be encouraged to take plenty of fluid during the urinary tract infections. Okay, we just saw that there are different sets of drugs that can be used during urinary tract infections, right? So let us look into the choice of the drug as to how do we come to a choice of certain drug. It is generally said that a renally excreted antibiotic which has long half-life, which is effective in short dose with low incidence of side effects, is an ideal drug for the treatment of UTI. Okay, let us look into the long half-life. If a drug has got long half-life, then the drug will remain in the body for a long period of time. Thereby, a single dose will be effective in treating UTI for a long period of time. That's why the dosing frequency of the drug can be relatively low. The second thing, effective in short courses. If it is effective in short courses, then we can get the urinary tract infection treated in short course, that is maybe 3-day period, 5-day period. We'll not need to go to 10-day or 14-day period. Low incidence of side effects is ideal for treatment of any kind of disease, and so is the case in case of UTI as well. The variation in antibiotic sensitivity is known to exist between different areas and different countries for sure, but that's why medicines should be given based on the knowledge of local causative organism and their sensitivities. This type of data is presented as antibiogram. We'll be looking at an antibiogram, for example, in the next slide. The narrowest spectrum drug, again, that retains the appropriate susceptibility is recommended if multiple agents, including the initial peric choice, are found to have susceptibility. Okay. So, this is an example of an antibiogram that is used in UTIs. Have a look at the different antimicrobial agents. Yes, we have talked about, we have seen in earlier cases that drugs like amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, and we said cephalosporin earlier, right? Fluoroquinolones and trimethoprim, we did discuss about these things. It is not mandatory that we go to each and every drug out here. We just basically outline the important drugs that are used most frequently in case of UTIs in today's class. Okay, these are the list of different agents that are used. This shows sensitivity of the organism or uropathogen to the drugs, right? This shows intermediate sensitivity and this shows resistance. So we can see that most of the agents that cause urinary tract infections have gained resistance in case with to amoxicillin. Sensitivity is when the pathogen is sensitive to the antibiotic that is tested right? And we use the sensitivity data and we choose the drug with narrowest spectrum to move ahead in definitive therapy. This is intermediate sensitivity, which says it can either be sensitive or be resistant as well in some cases. Okay, so let us look into the choice of the drug. The choice of the drug depends upon the likely susceptibility of the organism, which is saw with sensitivity, right? The ease of administration of the drug, the efficacy, the freedom from adverse effects, and the relative cost as well. Okay, now moving on to individual drugs. Potassium citrate. We said that earlier, if the person with urinary tract infection is showing only mild symptoms, in that case, we can use potassium citrate. Potassium citrate is basically a urine alkalizer, right? It gives relief in case of discomfort or in mild lower urinary tract infections like cystitis and urethritis. The side effects may be hyperkalemia on prolonged high doses and mild diuresis. However, there is need for caution in elderly and renal impairment or cardiac disease. Again, it should not be given with nitrofurantoin since it is inactive at higher pH. Okay, the second agent that we'll be discussing is trimethoprim. Trimethoprim is the drug of choice in non-pregnant women with an uncomplicated urinary tract infection. The long-term use does not increase resistance. That is why trimethoprim is again the drug of choice out here. Another reason is that it is ineffective, inexpensive, and that it does not interact with oral contraceptive pill. Normally, women may be on oral contraceptive pill, the married woman, right? And that is why a drug that does not interact with oral contraceptive pill is generally preferred. Trimethoprim, when used singly, is bacteriostatic in nature. That is, it inhibits the growth of the bacteria and relies on the host immune system to get rid of the bacteria. However, trimethoprim, when used along with sulfamethoxazole for the treatment of UTIs, the combination out here becomes bactericidal, showing synergistic action. Okay, in the basic pharmacology, when we talked about the combination of drugs, we did talk about synergistic action, right? Synergistic action means when the combination of drugs, they show more effect than the combined effect of the drug, we call it synergistic action. Like if 2 plus 2 were added, the normal effect of the drug would be 4. But if the effect of adding 2 plus 2 equals to 5 out here or more than 5, then we call that kind of effect as synergistic action. Here, both the drugs, sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim, they are individually bacteriostatic in nature, but however, when they are combined together, they offer bactericidal action. Therefore, we call it synergistic action. Trimethoprim, it basically works in the step of conversion of dihydrofolic acid to tetrahydrofolic acid. It inhibits the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase and thereby inhibits the conversion of PABA into DNA. It is a broad spectrum drug which affects both gram-positive and many gram-negative bacteria as well. It can be used in children above 6 months of age, and the side effects are skin reactions and gastrointestinal disturbances. However, it is contraindicated in case of pregnancy. The another drug that we talk about today is nitrofurantoin. Nitrofurantoin is concentrated in urine and it does not promote the resistance of organisms in fecal flora. It is therefore ideally suited for prophylaxis. It can be used during pregnancy, but however, it should be avoided at term because of the risk of neonatal hemolysis. If neonatal hemolysis occurs, then the baby can suffer from hemolytic anemia. Therefore, earlier, like nitrofurantoin, it was avoided during the third trimester of pregnancy as a whole, but nowadays that very time period has been decreased, and nowadays it is considered wise to avoid the drug nitrofurantoin from 38 weeks of pregnancy to 42 weeks of pregnancy. And again, it can also be used during lactation and does not interfere with oral contraceptive pill like trimethoprim. The next The mechanism of action of nitrofurantoin is that nitrofurantoin is activated by the bacteria by reduction via the flavoprotein nitrofurantoin reductase to unstable metabolites. It then disrupts the ribosomal RNA, DNA, and other intracellular components. It is bactericidal in nature and especially to bacteria that is present in acidic urine. That is why we said that potassium citrate should not be given with nitrofurantoin, because potassium citrate is an urine alkalizer, and if we give potassium citrate along with nitrofurantoin, then this is going to hamper the effect of the drug nitrofurantoin. Antagonistic effect is safe, right? Okay, the side effects out here. The side effects of nitrofurantoin include nausea, epigastric pain, and diarrhea. Again, hypersensitivity, fever, and chills may be seen. The prolonged use may be complicated by rare pulmonary reactions, peripheral neuritis, and hepatitis. It should be avoided in patients with impaired renal function and pregnant women. Now coming to another drug, amoxicillin. In the antibiogram that we saw earlier, we have seen that resistance to amoxicillin and the whole penicillin group is relatively high, right? So amoxicillin is used only when the resistance to penicillin is not present, or the infection, the organism that is causing the UTI is known to be sensitive. They are safe for use during pregnancy and lactation and are relatively inexpensive. The side effects of amoxicillin is diarrhea, skin reactions, genital leaching, and vaginal problems. Coamoxiclav are the combination of amoxicillin with clavulanic acid. It has broader base spectrum of action as compared to amoxicillin only, because we are adding a beta-lactamase out here, beta-lactamase inhibitor out here. So it increases the spectrum of effects. Coamoxicillin, which is the combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, it has got relatively broader spectrum of action because we are adding the beta-lactamase inhibitor clavulanic acid out here, right? And by addition of clavulanic acid, we are increasing the spectrum of amoxicillin. But because the combination is relatively more expensive, it should be used as a second line agent. For amoxiclav, it comes as 500 mg of amoxicillin and 125 mg of clavulanic acid. It has been used during pregnancy and is probably safe. However, the experience is limited with coamoxiclav. Okay, now coming to another drug, fosfomycin. Oral fosfomycin is approved as a single 3-gram dose to treat uncomplicated urinary tract infection, that is acute cystitis, in women due to susceptible strains of E. coli and Enterococcus faecalis. The mechanism of fosfomycin is it inactivates the enzyme enolpyruvyl transferase. It blocks the first steps in bacterial cell wall synthesis and thereby exerts bactericidal effects. Bacterial cell wall synthesis are generally considered bactericidal drugs like amoxicillin we discussed earlier. It also reduces the adherence of bacteria to uroepithelial cells. Earlier, when we were talking about the urinary tract infections, especially the ascending bacterial infections, we said that normally the bacteria that adhere to the uroepithelial cells, they are more likely to cause urinary tract infections. And almost all the agents that cause urinary tract infections that have the capability to adhere to the uroepithelial cells and also move forward to cause ascending bacterial infection, right? They have got either cilia or flagella. Fosfomycin has got a broad spectrum of in vitro activity and covers almost all the organisms that cause UTIs. The side effects are nausea, upset stomach, mild diarrhea, headache, dizziness, vaginal itching, or discharge. Okay, now coming on to quinolones. Quinolones and fluoroquinolones, they are one of the most used drugs in UTIs in our healthcare setting. Quinolones are basically divided. They are either grouped as quinolones or as fluoroquinolones. Quinolones are the first generation, like nalidixic acid, oxalic acid. These are the first class agents of quinolones. And chloroquinolones, they form the second, third, and fourth generation agents. Okay, let us have a look. Valdecoxib acid, it is a prototype drug of the quinolone antibiotics. It is effective against most urinary pathogens. However, it has got relative disadvantages like gastrointestinal tolerance, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and abdominal pain. Also, the another problem is that of frequent dosing. Quinolones are the first generation quinolones. They need to be given 4 times on a daily basis. And this is relatively problematic. The another problem is the need to avoid it pregnancy and lactation, and also the need to avoid in neonates. All the quinolones and fluoroquinolones, this will be avoided in children below 12 years of age. The newer agents, the fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, and norfloxacin, they are more preferred. Okay, fluoroquinolones should only be used in resistant cases, in which patients who cannot tolerate other agents, or in nosocomial infections and in complicated UTIs. They should not be given pregnant women, to lactating women, or to children because of the risk of inducing arthropathy. When used for uncomplicated cases, the chances of emergence of resistance is also increased. That is why it should be used only in case of complicated UTIs and nosocomial infections. Okay, FDA has recently mandated black box warnings for fluoroquinolones, in that they are known to cause increased risk of tendinitis and tendon rupture in some patients above 55 years of age. Okay, now coming to another drug, methenamine. Methenamine is an urinary antiseptic, quite like nitrofurantoin. It has got no risk of resistance. The mechanism of action is that in acidic environment, the methenamine is hydrolyzed into ammonia and formaldehyde. Formaldehyde itself is bactericidal in nature, and it possesses non-specific antimicrobial activity because it works by denaturing proteins and nucleic acid of the bacteria. It is present either as it comes as hippurate or mandelate salt, which forms acidic urine, and it aids by providing the acidic environment to promote the formation of formaldehyde. Because methenamine has little antimicrobial activity in alkaline environment, so formation of formaldehyde does not occur until the pH of environment falls below 6. Some treatment regimens even include the use of ascorbic acid in order to further acidify the urinary environment. And again here, potassium citrate should not be given with methenamine because again that is a urinary alkalizer. The side effects of methenamine is nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal cramps, anorexia. Let us look into the prevention measures of UTIs. The first is to drink plenty of liquid. That means especially water, right? Second, urinate promptly whenever the urge arises. Avoid retaining urine for a long time after you feel the urge to void. And empty the bladder as soon as possible after sexual activity. And avoid potentially irritating feminine products, like deodorant, sprays, and powders. Okay, that is all for today. Thank you.